Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. Today we're going to continue looking at how to beat the traps in all the Saw movies, and we're approaching the end here pretty rapidly. Saw 6 is a special movie to me because it's actually the first horror film that I ever watched. I was very shocked back then, however when I recently watched it, the scariest moment was when I realized that one of the characters is Roderick in Diary of a Wimpy Kid. Anyways, in the movie we follow William Easton, an executive for a health insurance firm that often denies coverage for bogus pre-existing conditions. He gets kidnapped and must participate in what is supposed to be the final Jigsaw game to save his family. So let's get started and find out how to keep everyone alive. The movie starts off with one of the most extreme traps in the franchise. Co-workers Eddie and Simone wake up on opposite sides of a dark room with a machine strapped to their head. They're separated by a scale behind a cage, and on the table in front of them are knives and meat cleavers. After they both wake up, it's explained that they need to cut off parts of their own body and drop them on the scale. The one who gets more weight on their side will survive, while the loser will get two screws drilled into their skull by the machine on their head. The timer begins and Eddie uses the knife to cut off his belly fat and drops it on the scale. Since Simone is a lot skinnier, she realizes that the only way for her to survive is to amputate one of her limbs. As the time ticks away, Eddie already has some weight on the scale, while Simone's part is still pretty empty. She then uses the meat cleaver to take off her whole arm and puts it on her side. The arm weighs more than the fat, so Eddie gets killed. For this one, there are a few things you could do. Most people's first instinct is to put their shoes on the scale to give them a slight advantage, but Jigsaw already thought of that and put the victims in there barefoot, so that's not an option. But the helmet has a pretty simple design which you can exploit. If you lose this game, you can stick one of the knives into the helmet to jam the gears that turn the screw into your head. It's very accessible and can easily fit the blade, making it worth a try. You can also try to cut the wires to the helmet, which might stop the motor twisting the screws. Something else they could have done is not move when they wake up. The trap gets activated when they pull the triggers out of their helmet when they get off the chair. Simone accidentally removed the trigger, but when Eddie woke up, she could have told him to not move or they will both die. This could have been more effective than merely saying don't get up. That way the trigger would have stayed in the helmet and their test wouldn't have started. After that we see Jill Tuck, John's ex-girlfriend. Following his death in Saw 3, she received a mysterious box with numerous envelopes containing information on the people that will be in the final game. It was John's dying wish that these people get tested. Soon after, Hoffman visits Jill and demands that she give him the envelopes. He says he's going to take control of the game and finish this himself. Jill gives him 5 of them, however there's one envelope that she keeps just for herself. We cut to William Easton, an insurance executive, as he's working late in his office. Suddenly, the power gets cut and somebody breaks into the building. He tries to hide but eventually gets kidnapped. When he wakes up, he's tied to a machine with an oxygen mask on his face. The TV starts playing and it's John Kramer himself. It turns out that William's company denied John his cancer treatment, which led to his death soon after. Now John will get revenge by putting Will through a series of tests. He has cuffs on each of his limbs, and if the traps he encounters aren't completed in 60 minutes, they will explode, leaving him without hands or feet, and he'll never see his family again. Will's first test is that he needs to escape this machine. However, he's not alone in the room, but is actually competing against someone else. What happens is that every time they take a breath, these two clamps will tighten and push into their body until it crushes them. The test begins and they both begin to hold their breath. Since William's opponent is a heavy smoker, he can't hold his breath as long. Eventually, the man starts breathing and gets badly injured. He keeps gasping for air and gets completely crushed by the machine. Will's contraption then opens and he goes to the next test. The first thing you should do here is, if you do have to breathe, only take small breaths. We see that the pump, measuring how much oxygen they're inhaling, has a little bit of wiggle room, which is something you can try to cheat. You also want to stand sideways in this trap instead of straight. That way, once the clamps close in on you, they won't instantly hurt you. You might still get injured, but it's better than dying. That way, it's possible that both people make it out alive, because William's machine opens up after the other man took about 5 breaths, meaning that it doesn't close all the way. If he stood sideways, he probably would have lived. Then, after William was released, he can go to the other man, remove his mask, and have him wait for the police. The last thing you can do is use your knees to break the mechanism that measures your oxygen intake. Both men are only secured by their arm chains and the belt by their hips, but their legs are completely free to move. We see this when the camera pans down on the smoker as he pees himself. There it's shown that they're only standing on a metal plate, so they can try to kick the oxygen pump. The pump has a small needle that moves up and down this coil when you're inhaling, but if you kick the needle to bend it, it would no longer register their breathing. When William releases himself, he goes towards the end of the room and gets the first key to one of the exploding cuffs. Then we cut to a mother and son trapped in a room with a tub of corrosive acid. The same 1 hour timer is counting down for them. They see that next to the acid container is a lever saying live on one side and die on the other. And in the room next to them is a woman who's an investigative journalist. They're all confused and wonder why they're even here. We go back to William as he walks into the next trap. Here he encounters the most difficult game in the entire movie. He goes into a room and stands in front of a window. It's mentioned that he needs to take the chains in front of him into his arms. Once he does, the lights turn on and he sees two of his colleagues standing on retractable platforms with a barbed wire noose around their neck. Both of them have their hands tied behind their back. The puppet then flies towards the window and tells him that he needs to choose between who lives and who dies. If he lets go of one of the chains, the plank will retract and that person will be hung. On the left side is an older diabetic woman who has a family, and on the right is a young healthy man who no one will miss. William tries to hold both chains, but they get pulled harder and harder. Once there is too much resistance, he decides to save the older woman and lets go of the young man's chains. The man's handcuffs get released and the platform drops. He flies towards the window and gets hung by the noose. Now there are many things you can do here, but most of them require you to know what happens beforehand. One option is that you can simply hook the chains back to where they were, as they don't immediately get pulled. But you have to know that the chains will move in the first place. So really the only option here seems to be that the person who gets dropped needs to grab onto the barbed wire noose and hold themselves up. Because a few seconds before the platform drops, we see that his cuffs are cut loose and his arms are free to move. So he needs to grab onto the rope so that he doesn't get choked. He then gets pulled up and can maybe exit the game. After this trap, William gets the key to the second handcuff and continues. He walks into a hall filled with steam and hot pipes. In this room, his lawyer finds herself in a maze. She has 90 seconds to find a way out, but some parts have pipes blowing scorching air directly on her. For the woman to make it through, Will needs to go to certain levers and pull them to stop the steam on the woman's level, but instead blowing the hot air on him. If the time runs out and she hasn't exited the maze, the machine strapped to her body will shoot a bolt into her head, killing her. The timer starts and the woman makes her way through. As she encounters the different steam pipes, Will relieves her by pulling the levers and they both only suffer minor burns. Towards the exit, however, there's a big section with a lot of hot air blowing directly into the space. Will once again pulls the lever and the woman walks in, but he can't take the heat for that long. He decides to let go and the woman gets pretty severely burned, but she makes it out alive. She then sees a picture telling her that the key to the trap on her is sewn inside William. She takes the nearby saw and tries to cut him to retrieve the key. However, the time eventually runs out and she is shot by the bolt. This one is really the simplest trap in the whole movie. For the maze, the woman can make her way through without getting injured if Will continuously pulls the relief levers. What Will can do to not get burned by them is step over the railing and push the levers from an angle where he doesn't get burned. He can also take the tie around his neck and put it on the lever. This allows him to pull it from a distance or next to the pipe. For the bolt gun on the woman, she can simply take the saw that she's given and cut the straps that tie the machine to her body. That way she can get rid of the trap in seconds without hurting anyone. With only 27 minutes left, Will gets the third key and unlocks one more cuff. We briefly cut to Hoffman as he and the FBI agents investigate the Jigsaw murders. They tell him that they found a tape from a previous trap, but the voice has been significantly altered. Of course, what they don't know is that it's Hoffman's voice on the tape. Since the audio is really distorted, they will try to unscramble it and find out who Jigsaw's accomplice is. Back with William, he stands in front of a room with a spiral on the door. He hears some of his co-workers talking and asks them what's going on. They only know that they're spinning on something and that it's completely dark. William then enters to see what's going on. The lights turn on and inside is a big carousel behind a cage. On it are six people who work for him and they're all tied to metal bars on the carousel. Suddenly, the TV starts playing and informs them what's going on. Inside the cage is a shotgun that will shoot all the people if Will doesn't act. What he needs to do is once again choose between who lives and who dies. Overall, four of the six people must die, but he has a chance to save two of them. The carousel will stop on each of the people and load the gun. If William decides that he wants that person to live, he must put his hands in a box and press two buttons. His hand will then be impaled through the center, but the shotgun will not fire. The game begins and the carousel stops at each of the people. William decides to save two of the women and lets the rest die. So for the box where you need to press the two buttons, you can simply put in two hands and use one finger to press each button. Since your palm isn't inside the box, the bolt will not impale you. But that's the easy part. The difficult task is keeping everyone alive. What the people on the carousel can do is unlock their shackles. If you look closely when the camera zooms in, you can see that they're being held in place by chains, but by the end is a simple carabiner hook. I even found one that looks the exact same. And at least one of the guys has his hands close enough together so that he can reach the hook. If the group took a moment to look at each other and see how they're tied down, the guys would notice that all they'd have to do is open the hook, undo their chains, and then they can get off. Now I'll let you guys decide if this method should count, since it's more of a movie production thing because they don't really want to tie the actors down. But fortunately, there's another way for them to live. The way the shotgun shoots is that the trigger is fixed to a bicycle chain. As the chain moves, it slowly squeezes the trigger. William can stop this by taking a long stick and putting it through the cage to get the chain off the gears. For those of you who ride bicycles a lot, you probably know how easy it can be to break this type of mechanism. You pretty much only need to lift up the chain and move it a little to the left and right, and the entire thing falls apart. Then the gears can no longer pull the shotgun's trigger. The chain is also shown to be put on there pretty loose, so it's easy to remove. There's also a lot of space in this room where Will can find a skinny stick to fit through the fence, and in case there isn't one, he can go back outside and grab one of the metal sticks seen by the barrels. The door isn't shown to lock behind him, so Will can just go back and grab a bar. He can do the same with this piece of railing right here. It's small enough to put through the space on the side. He can then use it to push the bicycle chain off the gears. When William finishes this test, he gets the last key to the cuffs and undoes them. Now there's no longer the threat of his hands or feet being blown away. After that, we go to the audio lab as the FBI unscrambles the voice tape. As they get the real audio, they notice that it's Hoffman's voice. Hoffman acts fast and quickly kills everyone in the room and asks Agent Perez who else knows about him, and she tells him everybody. He then empties a gasoline tank and sets the place on fire. We return to William as his time is quickly running out. He rushes into the last room and the door closes behind him. He's now trapped in a cage with 1 second left on the clock. Then the metal doors open and he can see the reporter as well as the mother and son. It turns out that the reporter is his sister and the other people are the family of a man who died because William's insurance firm denied him coverage. Suddenly a tape of John starts playing and reveals what is really happening. It's up to the mother and son to decide over William's fate. That's what the lever is for. Should they forgive him or do they want to get their revenge? Live or die? William pleads for his life, but Roderick decides that he wants to get revenge and flips the lever to die. Suddenly, a grid with needles flips down from the ceiling and stabs Will in the back. The needles have tubes running into them, which come from the acid container. His body then gets filled with the highly corrosive acid and he dies. In this trap, time is really on William's side. There are probably 5 or 6 seconds between them realizing what is about to happen and it actually happening. In that time, Will could have ducked below the grid and it wouldn't have hit him. There are also 3 to 4 seconds between the needles impaling him and the acid running into his body. In that time, he could have tried to remove the grid from his back. Other than that, there isn't really much you can do here except for maybe pulling out the tubes to the needles, as there are only 2 big ones which then split into all the smaller ones. Pulling them out would allow him to live, and then they can spray the acid on the cage to escape. But even though William died, it's not over yet, because we see Hoffman returning to William's trial to watch over what happened. However, Jill Tuck has also arrived and is hiding in the building. Hoffman sees that she left him a note, and this note fills in a story gap from 3 movies ago. It turns out that Amanda was part of the reason why John lost his child. That was the moment that turned John into the Jigsaw Killer, but he never suspected Amanda. Hoffman knew this and blackmailed her and told Amanda to kill Lynn in Saw 3. This led to Jeff, Amanda, and John all dying. When that flashback is over, Jill walks in on Hoffman and electrocutes him. She ties him to the chair and gets a new and approved reverse bear trap. This was one of the items from the box that Jill received when John died. It turns out that there was one final envelope in there that Jill didn't give Hoffman, and it was about Hoffman himself. John still wanted to test him. Joe puts the reverse bear trap on him and gives him 60 seconds to escape. But before he dies, she leaves the room. Then Hoffman does something that loops all the way back to my first video about Saw. He breaks his hands to get out of the chair, after which he puts his mask in between two metal bars and rips out his face. For this one, How to Beat It is covered in the first video, and Hoffman also manages to cheat it himself. He does this by putting the mask in a space that forces it closed. That way it can't open and it can't kill him. This was also my main solution for the first time that we saw this trap. So that's how you can survive Saw 6. As always, let me know how you would beat the traps, and I hope I get to see you guys in the Saw 3D video. There we'll finish off Hoffman's story and really kind of close the main Saw plot before we head into the final movie. Anyways, I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye guys.